2 years. And as I was, you know, being approached about the position, I was looking at Iowa, and I looked, oh my gosh, it's 93% white. There's no black people there. I'm not going to go there. You know, but certainly as you peel away the layers, you see so much more about Iowa and Iowa City in particular. And so our demographics, for example, that tells us about our patient population for UI Healthcare last year indicates that in terms of the white population is about 85%. So that other 15% is a wide range of people from a wide range of backgrounds, not only here in the United States, but who have come from other countries. When we look to see what languages people have indicated in terms of their preferred language, in addition to English, there were 14 other different languages that were indicated by patients at UI Healthcare. That also drives us in terms of the work that we are doing to ensure that we are providing this culturally responsive care as a way, again, to try to eliminate those healthcare disparities and to ensure that patients are receiving equitable care. And that really is the vision, you know, kind of the ideal where we get to a nation where everyone has that care that they deserve. The other thing that I want to mention along this idea of sort of healthcare disparities and culturally responsive care is that as providers, that means, again, sort of looking inside and identifying and recognizing that we all have unconscious biases that will come through regardless of who we're interacting with. And again, when I'm talking with our physicians and with our medical students, you know, I talk with them about this piece of don't be afraid of it. And I know we hear the term bias and people sort of want to go, no, not me. You know, and you may be familiar with the implicit association test developed by Harvard. And I know for me, I was surprised when I took it. I'm the diversity person. I know this stuff. I'm like, oh my gosh, I have biases. You know, and we all have them. They're unconscious sometimes and we don't realize it. So then the next step is being aware of that, acknowledging it, and now how do we address those and leave those at the door where we're interacting and when we're in a clinical encounter. So that certainly becomes another piece of this. And so then that awareness of also of what our own cultural aspects are that we may be bringing to the clinical encounter and how do we meld those with what the patient is bringing to the encounter. So we may have a patient, for example, who is Native American, who has certain practices that he or she would want to use when they're in this, when they are trying to treat something. How can I continue to use those along with what the physician is saying that I need to do? And if they're not harmful to this person, and if this person wants to continue to use their herbal teas, let them do that along with what we're recommending. So there are all those different aspects, again, that come into play when we're talking about eliminating healthcare disparities and delivering care that is culturally responsive, that recognizes the differences that everyone brings to a clinical encounter. And again, hopefully getting to that point where, as Peter started, that health care is a right, not a privilege. Thank you.
We have about 10 minutes for questions and comments. Mm-hmm. If anyone would like to start there. I think we've heard a broad swath of topics across the health, natural, and social sciences here. I'll turn to Cherie then. You had a question for Michelle.
Yeah,
we'll start with that.
Do you want to illuminate on that, please?
You thought, oh, I put it out there. Maybe I shouldn't have.
So I think you indicated that there are some dentists who are even questioning or even are saying, is it a right or is it a privilege in terms of, I guess, dental care or health insurance? But
All right, so the question was, do dentists disagree as to whether health or dental care is a right or a privilege? And I would say yes, because if they all agreed that it was a right, then I think everybody would be able to get care. And there wouldn't be this problem of some dentists saying, well, I'm not going to see Medicaid patients. They may not see Medicaid patients for a lot of reasons. They may use the excuse that it's because of poor reimbursement rates, or it may be for a variety of other reasons. But I think if all dentists agreed that it was a fundamental right, then they would open their doors to more people. I don't want to badmouth dentists, so when I was preparing my presentation, I asked my husband if I was doing that. He's a chemistry professor. You know, and certainly it's not all dentists, right? Because there are a lot of dentists who do provide free care. They do go out into nursing homes and provide care. They work in community health centers. You know, they do volunteer work in the country, out in communities, or out in schools, for example, and do sealant programs. But there are some dentists who pick and choose who they volunteer.
And just to provide Michelle a little more cover, we do a lot of work studying the safety net in general, and it's an issue that's not just in dentistry. In all aspects of healthcare, you've got people that are more or less likely to participate with underprivileged populations, underserved populations, different aspects of the safety net. And so I think it gets at that issue, that slide I showed earlier, about how 90% of our money goes into the healthcare delivery system, because that's the business side of things and that's where it's at. And then we don't often think about how do we look at things that are the public health side. You know, and right now with Ebola, all of a sudden everybody wants this robust public health service system that's going to serve us, but we don't really think about it much when we don't have these kinds of issues that pop up, and that's when we really need it and it should be going on all over the place. Yes?
I think I have a question or maybe a comment that you can address that reaches each area. You mentioned the Ebola outbreak, and there was an article about a month ago that I was reading, basically big data, that was analyzing mentions of the Ebola outbreak by hashtags on Twitter and reposts. And when you looked at the graph, the moment that there was a single person even rumored to have Ebola in America, the number of mentions shot, I mean, exponentially, more than a factor of two. And prior to that point, you know, it had been in the hundreds, and suddenly it was in the thousands. And I think that kind of speaks to some of our unconscious biases, but obviously this becomes a pretty apparent bias through big data. And then the question of how do we respond to that, you know, engages with how do we deal with underserved communities, and it also asks the question about how do we deal with medicine across continents, because the preposterous idea was to ban travel from Africa to other regions, which seems kind of ridiculous. So I don't know if anybody wants to jump on that.
I'll pick one little aspect, and it developed a conflict for me, and had a lot of, I don't have a resolution, so I'm going to share my conflict confusion. And that is that I know we don't develop drugs, didn't develop drugs for Ebola because it doesn't fit the healthcare business model. So we weren't doing that. But once it became apparent that we needed drugs, all of a sudden anything that looked like the correct drug was then given to people to see if it worked. Here's my conflict. I am very much involved in appropriate studies on medication use, and I really believe in our institutional review board and the fact that we use a very careful process to be sure that we're not harming people in the process of seeing if we're helping people. And so here's a conflict that I have, because I understand about people are dying. Well, and at first we thought most people would die because that's previous outbreaks. Now we're seeing that that's not the case. So how many of these experimental ideas, and there's a whole bunch of them that have come out that are outside of my worldview. I might say crazy or different, but they're just outside of my worldview that we're trying. How many of those cause more harm than good? So it created a conflict, and it's in a good way. We're having great conversations in our college about this.
Yeah, what your comment there is really quite interesting and illuminating in terms of big data, for example. You can also see studies of how the fact that we have access to that information actually did a better job of predicting the outbreak in the spatial spread of that in particular and other examples. You also see where the fact that we now have cellular technology, that we have information in villages and around the world that we didn't have before. So, and so there's, on the plus side, it's all this information that's available to us. And then you also raise the issue that there are, you know, how do we interpret information that's coming over the social media? You know, is the different venues biased in some way? How do we deal with that? And that's just great questions, and I think it's ahead of us how we're going to deal with that. Again, I think it's exciting here in the informatics initiative that we're already bringing together lots of people in the social sciences and, you know, across the board, engineers, politicians, sociologists, healthcare professionals are using social media data collected and try to understand what's going on. I think we're at least have the opportunity to coordinate and move forward, you know, really explore this together from both from all aspects of the academy. So it's exciting, it's a challenge, but it's a great comment and observation.
Right, and I think it touches on that challenge of taking that science and information and creating policy. Right, and that link, and on the science side, one of the interesting things I think with NSF in the last couple of years, it used to be very basic science oriented, we just want the information. Now you really have to have a social science, behavioral science component, because otherwise that information is useless if we don't know how it's going to translate into people and how it's going to be put out there and used. Yes.
I was curious as to whether the potential decision not to have fluoride in Des Moines was based on economic or political reasoning.
Do I take that?
No, I repeat the question.
Des Moines did opt to keep it.
Okay.
Yeah, and they did actually rely on a lot of the science, and one of our colleagues in the college is one of the international experts on fluoride, was one of the people that was feeding information. And obviously that's that link between the science, the politics, and the policy, and that's one where we would, I think, agree that it worked, because they did use that science in that decision-making process, but still had to incorporate that into the politics, because you have to listen to what your constituents are wanting, whether, you know, and then, and how to parlay those things. I think it's an example of all of the issues that we're talking about.
Just an aside to that, I mean, I think that's a great example where, you know, the scientific reputation was able to enter into the conversation in a very positive way.
Why was it questioning, or why did it arise in the first place?
Why was it being questioned?
Why would anybody question whether you have to?
Well, go back to the Dr. Strangelove movie.
Oh, yes.
And we've been having the same discussion since the 1950s.
Okay, so here's my point.
Right. And the interesting thing to fluoride from a political is that you've got people on the right and the left who both oppose it for very different reasons. But you want the policymakers, again, to be listening to the science and judging their constituents. Last question.
I wanted to bring into discussion, again, health as a right. And there was a question about whether dentists believe it or not, and some do and some don't, some accept Medicaid patients, some do not. When health is left to the free-floating of free markets, then that's what you get, because those people are looking after their best interest, financially speaking, and we cannot accept from individuals to make sure health as a right is provided to people. But our policymakers are not seeing health and healthcare as a right. When we go to Washington, D.C., majority of the people there who are supposed to represent us don't see it as such. And they leave it at the hands of the drug companies. And I think that slide was the most impressive slide, when very little of healthcare delivery is affecting our health. 50% of the investment is right there, majority of which is serving the hospitals and the drug companies. So how do we deal with this as a nation? What should we do?
Big question. None of them want to answer it. That's the big question.
Yeah, I think that is the question, right? How do you influence policymakers to do what you want? Are they reflecting what we as citizens want or not, and how do you influence that? And I think ultimately, how does the science that we all do, how does that influence into the question?
With
that, I think that would be a good place to leave it and turn it over to the next panel.
Well, okay, thank you very much, Peter.